can. Good morning.
Good morning.
So nice to see all of you here today. Yeah, I think of Laura and I just a little bit. So grateful to have Eli here on the soundboard. Has my name.
I don't know how.
That's good. Say what you know. Say what you don't know. Thank you, Wesley. That's the man in charge. Today is the third Sunday after Easter. It's so good to have all of you here today. A special day because we have the funniest preacher in the congregation preaching today. See, I'm just setting the bar really high for you.
Yeah, I know.
Just making it worse. Yeah.
Okay. Well, the bar wasn't real high, with all due respect.
She just threw it out, there's a challenge. Yeah. But no, we're looking forward to that. Thank you, Rob, so much for being willing to preach today. We begin our service of worship praying together. Many of you sent prayer requests to me during the week or filled out the slips at the back of the room on the clipboards. And so with that in mind, let's be in an attitude of prayer. God, it's a wonderful thing to be able to be here on a Sunday morning, to be able to create time and space in our schedules to spend with you intentionally for an hour. We talked to you all week, God, but it's just so precious to be able to be here and be with other people who believe, as we do, that you are our God, that you are our creator, our source, our foundation, that you are the one who brings us life, hope, peace, new life, God. Thank you for the gift of faith that you've given to each of us in the room, and I ask that through the Holy Spirit you can supply our needs today, that you would help to form us into disciples more like Jesus so that we can represent you better to the world. And for this same reason, God, we ask this morning that you would allow us to shed anything that we're bringing with us that's not glorifying to you, that takes away our ability to witness to you well. If we've committed sins this week that have harmed ourselves or others or you, God, we now name them in our hearts before you and ask that you would help us to let go of these things, that you would empower us next time we find ourselves in a similar situation. Just allow us to do better because we love you and you've done so much for us. God, thank you for hearing our confession this morning and help us to receive your forgiveness and know that you really love us and that you are sending us whole on our way out into the world.
When you're weary,
Doesn't it look good? Yeah, Pam, the new preschool. gorgeous. Go look at it. Okay, if you haven't seen it, it's great. Lord God, thank you for showing us how to be kind and loyal friends. Thank you for King David and Mephibosheth. And thank you for Sunday school. Please allow these kids to have a meaningful time this morning. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
So he turned and went off in a rage. Naaman's servants went to him and said, "Father, my father, if the prophet had told you to do something, some great thing, would you not have done it? How much more then, when he tells you, wash and be cleansed?" So he went down and dipped himself in the Jordan 7 times, as the man of God had told him. And his flesh was restored and became clean, like that of a young boy. This is the word of the Lord.
Please pray with me. Dear God, thank you for giving me this opportunity to speak. As you know, I have never had a microphone I didn't like. But please allow me to impart what I think is hopefully a good message. And hopefully this, what I'm about to say, means something to somebody here. Amen. So, I love to guest preach. I've done it a couple of times, and I really do enjoy it. Where I get hung up is that this just isn't me getting up here and telling stories, right? And that's kind of what I want. But Holly says, "Well, where's the message?" And I'm like, this is story time with Rob. This isn't about a message. And yesterday, I picked that reading for a reason that we'll get into in a little bit, but I texted Rachel the reading, and she texted me back and said, "Well, is that 1 Kings or 2 Kings?" I'm like, "What? There are two?" And I looked up, because I didn't know. All right, so here we go. As a lot of you might know, I love hockey, and I've been a hockey fan for as long as I can remember. And I think part of it comes from where I grew up. So I grew up in Jamaica Plain. In the 70s. And in the 70s, the Bruins and Bobby Orr were like the Patriots are now, the number one team in town, and they could do anything they wanted to do, and the people just loved the Bruins. My dad being one of them, and he imparted a lot of that to me. My mother used to tell a story about the night she went into labor with my brother. The Bruins were on, so my father had a dilemma. I have a wife and labor, but the Bruins were on. So my quick-thinking father, who will never win any Husband of the Year awards, put my mother in a cab and sent her to the hospital. Later on that night, I guess after my brother was born, she called my dad from the hospital and said, "You know, you have another son." And my father said, "Great, let's name him Derek. Because Derek Sanderson actually scored the game-winning goal in that game." So my brother's name is Michael. And I think that his name is Michael because that's the name of the cab driver that drove him. So I love hockey. There's a part of me that actually feels grateful for hockey because I never would have met Holly if it wasn't for hockey. I had 2 requests at our wedding, right? So Holly and I met playing in a co-ed floor hockey league. And when we got engaged, I just had 2 requests. I wanted chicken fingers as a past appetizer, and I thought it'd be really cool if when we came out of the church, all of our hockey friends were standing like in an honor guard, holding their sticks up. Both of those requests were denied. So when TJ was old enough, we put him through a learn to skate program. He transitioned into learn to play hockey. And he went through mics. And if you've ever been involved in youth sports or Cub Scouts or anything, really, part of the challenge is that you need people to step up and volunteer. And that can be tough because timing issues or people just don't want to help or they don't feel qualified. And hockey's no different than that. The reason hockey's different is because You actually have to know how to play hockey. Like, anybody can just throw a soccer ball out there for a four-year-old and say, okay, soccer time. You actually have to know how to skate. So the pool of people who can actually step up and volunteer is a lot smaller than for other sports. So when TJ got to the Mite level, the league put out a call. We need help, we need volunteers, we need coaches. And I said, okay, I'll coach. And I was looking forward to it, and in my head I was thinking, like, someday there's going to be some kid that I coach to save, like, a family of people from a burning building. And in an interview he's going to say, this is for you, Coach Rob, because you taught me about leadership and, you know, that kind of thing. And it can still happen. I still have that vision. But hockey took a little bit of a sacrifice because there's two practices a week and there are games on the weekends. So if it's an early afternoon practice at like 4 o'clock, I have this move where I walk out into the hallway in front of my office and I look both ways and then I run. Because I don't think you can notice me leaving early. So I'm at the rink a lot and I'm cold a lot. And you might say, well, maybe that's not worth it, right? But there's something about it. There's something about working with the kids, being at the rink, running the drills, watching them improve, you know, through all of the practices, that just makes it worthwhile. And it's enriching. And I really do appreciate it. It's not much different than Aldersgate, right? I mean, we put a call out for greeters, coffee hour hosts, people to help out at a breakfast, people to go on the main mission trip. And pretty soon you find yourself there doing that, scooping out eggs at a breakfast, greeting people at the door. And maybe some of the things that we ask people to do, or that you, it's hard, right? It's not easy. But you get something out of it. It's worthwhile and it's enriching. And you wouldn't trade it for anything. So when I think back to that first year that I coached, that was 2 years ago, right before the first practice, a parent came up to me and said, this is my daughter. She's never played hockey before, but she skated a lot on a pond, and she has played some pond hockey. And I said, great. I said, you know, I'm sure she'll be fine. Parent was really nervous, she could tell. So I watched her daughter get on the ice, and she took two steps and fell, and picked herself up, and took two more steps and fell, and then went over and held onto the boards and worked her way around the ice. And I was thinking in my head, like, I wonder if that pond was frozen. This doesn't look like a kid that ever skated on a pond before. And we had an interesting mix of kids. We had some kids that could really play, and then we had other kids that, much like the girl who couldn't skate, that we had other kids who couldn't skate, we had kids who didn't know how to pass, how to shoot, how to do anything. So we had a lot of work to do to try to achieve the goals that we wanted to achieve. In Proverbs chapter 24, verse 27, it says, put your outdoor work in order and get your fields ready. After that, build your house. So that was the approach we took with that team. Realizing that the skill level wasn't really high, we kind of backed off on some of the practices and just kind of focused in on foundational type work, teaching the kids how to skate, teaching the kids how to shoot, teaching the kids how to pass. And we only did drills that worked on that type of stuff. And that was our part of it. But the kids' part of it is they have to buy into that, right? They have to realize that what the coach is trying to tell them is worthwhile, it's working. This is how I'm going to improve, by listening to the coach. And with that group, it was interesting because we pulled them aside and say, okay, well, the reason that team scored was because, you know, you should have been there and you weren't, and, you know, next time you'll get it. And they used to ask us questions, okay, if this happens, where should I be? And it was really great to have that type of relationship with the kids. And they were just so open to being coached, and they wanted to learn, and it was so much fun. And because the season's so long, the season starts in September and it goes through April, you actually really get to know a lot of their backstories and a lot of their challenges. Some of them were apparent right from the first practice, but some of them you really just had to listen to them sometimes to figure out kind of what they were going through. We found out that there was a kid that had autism. We had a lot of kids with ADHD. We had one with a severe disability. Even our goalie had like an eyesight problem, and he had to wear special glasses, which is kind of funny. to think of a goalie who maybe doesn't see as well as a lot of people, but was still able to stop the puck. I remember being up in Haverhill in the locker room, and I was just, when you're a coach in the locker room, you tie a lot of skates. Like, that's what you do. You just, kids like, you tie your skates, you guys like to tie your skates. And like, when are you going to learn how to tie your own skates? But the thing that was interesting about that rink is it had a, like a really heavy metal door in the locker room that opened up into the hallway. And the kids kept pushing the door open. I was like, someone's going to get hit with that door. And the kid whose skates I was tying said to me, yeah, like what happened to me when I was four? And I said, what happened to you when you were four? His older brother played hockey. And I don't know if it was at that rink, but somebody opened up the metal door and hit him in the head and knocked him unconscious. And I was like, oh, wow, that's... And he's like, yeah, that was the first time. I said, well, wait a second. And then he think of being put on. Like, how many times did you get hit with the metal door? And he said, twice. I said, okay. Like, then you're really like, kids, please stay away from the metal door. But from the by the time the season ended, the improvement in these kids were amazing. Even the girl that couldn't skate in that first practice, by the end of the season, she was one of the better players on the team because she worked at it, because she was open to listening to what the coaches were trying to tell her, and she worked hard in practice. So, interactive sermon here. Wow. How do you think the season ended for that team? Win or lose? Did they win or lose? Eli, put it. Eli can. So they won.
That's a
celebration. Yeah, so that's a picture that was taken after the last horn sounded. And they beat Wilmington, I think. It was like 5-2 or something like that. And I love this picture. And I think the girl couldn't skate. She's like on the right-hand side with the ponytail. So yesterday, if you came to Hugh's funeral, you took a book home, a few euphemisms. I wish I had this like earlier. I would have. There were a lot in there that I think we could use.
And that picture
makes me cry. So when I looked through Hugh's euphemisms, I saw the one that said, "I cry at dry cleaner openings," and I don't know why this picture gets me. So, that was the end of that season, so the season ends and, you know, we all leave kind of on a high note, and the next season comes, and of course I agree to coach, because that was such a great experience. I'm like, hey, this is something that's going to easily be duplicated, and I can do this all the time. And when I saw the roster of the kids, there were some kids that were on this team, on the team that I was coached last year, and I was thankful for that. But then there were these other kids who I kind of know just through watching them in skill sessions. And they were good, but they were difficult. They wanted to do their own thing. And that was a challenge. And it was clear, like when we brought those kids together through the first couple of practices, that you couldn't turn your back on some of them. The second you turn your back, they're hitting somebody with their stick. They're laying on the ice. They're cross-checking another kid. They're not getting along. They're punching each other in the mask, and it's sort of like, guys, stop. And it just, what we tried the year before wasn't working. And the team wasn't really progressing the way that I thought they should have, because they had more talent than the team from the year before. So we got creative. And that's what a good coach does. A good coach realizes that, hey, what I'm trying right now isn't working. So we're going to try something else. And the guy I was coaching with came up with an idea where the hardest working kid, not the best kid, the hardest working kid that tried their hardest in practices and in the games on the weekend would get a special jersey, and they would get to wear that jersey for a week, and at the end of the week, they would get to pick another kid, right, who had worked hard and that kind of thing. And we said to the kids up front, like, Not every kid might get this jersey, because it's not something that we're just going to give to you because it's your turn. You have to earn it by working hard and practice. The other thing that we did was we put a count on passes, and we made it fun for them. So if you get to 50 passes in this game, you can run a drill in practice. You can ask the coaches to do something. We did one where if they got to 85 passes, the coaches would actually put on a figure skate. We would actually figure skate during one of the practices. But they didn't get there. They didn't get to 85. They got to 84, and I was really nervous. But I was willing to do it if they got to 85 and they got to 84, and luckily the horn sounded, so I didn't have to worry about that. But as the season went on, I started to hear things like, when is it my turn to get the jersey? And when we would award it to somebody else, some of the kids would say, well, what did he do that I didn't do? You know, like, just sort of saying, like, I haven't had it yet, and it's my turn. And it's like, this isn't a case where you just get it. You know, what we're trying to teach you guys is that maybe you just skate a little harder. Maybe you come back on defense. Maybe you back check a little bit more. And what I felt was that the idea was good, but it wasn't resonating with them. And a lot of them were just missing the point of what we were trying to accomplish with the jersey. So how do you think that season ended? They lost. They lost in the first round of the playoffs. That team had more talent and should have gone farther, but it just didn't come together the way that we had hoped and the way that it should have really come together. In that game that they lost, they were losing 2-1 in the third period, and the other coach and I made a decision. For the last 3 minutes, we just put the best 5 kids on the ice to try to tie the game up. But they didn't, and we lost. And I actually felt a sense of relief, because that was a difficult season. And in a way, I wanted them to win, but I was glad the season was over. Later that afternoon, I got an email from one of the parents who absolutely blasted me and the other coach for not having his son on the ice for the last 5 minutes of the game, or the last 3 minutes of the game. And what was really nice is that he CC'd all the other parents on there and basically said that we robbed his child of a chance to play in a playoff game, and we owe the kid an apology, and we owe an apology to the other kids who weren't on the ice in the last 3 minutes of the game. And I kind of think that that's a different sermon, but maybe the next time I guest preach, I can do one just on that email. And when I think about, like, when we think about history, right, history is tracked by years by BC and AD. So BC is the time before Christ, and AD is Anno Domini, or after death, which is all of the years after Jesus died. I track the years of my life a little different. The first one, the first part of my life I call JP, right? So those are my JP years, and that's when everything that I did and my behavior was sort of based on what I learned growing up in Jamaica Plain. The rest of the years of my life, the time that I'm in now, I call AH, that's called After Holly. where the behavior is mostly driven by what Holly tells me to do. So when I started to reply to their parents' email, there was a lot of the old rock, like the JP part of my life in that. And I showed it to Holly, and she shook her head. And she just said, no, can't send that. And I changed it to more of an AH type of response. I said I wish I had that book of euphemisms, because if I did, maybe I just would have said, I made a decision to try to win the game, and just don't get hurtsy feelings about it. So when I reflect on the two teams, the major difference comes down to just being coachable. The team with less talent had a really teachable spirit, and they wanted to get better. And while the other team, it wasn't every kid on the team, there were enough of them that were causing the issues. And you could argue that, well, no, you didn't do as good of a coaching job with the second team. I actually think I did a better job with the second team, because it was harder. we had to get more creative. We had to do a lot of different things that to try to drive the kids to do, you know, to be their best, to play at their best. And then if you think about the reading that Bob read about Naaman, what can we tell about Naaman from the reading, right? He was a soldier, he was highly regarded, he had leprosy, and he was probably used to getting his way, right? So he felt maybe there was a little sense of entitlement with Naaman. So when he goes to Israel and Elisha comes out and tells them to go bathe in the River Jordan and he'll be cured of his leprosy, rather than just take that one more step to do that, he doesn't. He gets mad and he storms off. And if it wasn't for the fact that his servant came up to him and basically said, what are you doing? You know, like, this isn't the hardest thing in the world to do. You just need to take that one more step. And luckily for Naaman, he's coachable. In that moment, he's coachable. And he changes his mind, and he jumps in the River Jordan, and he bathes 7 times, and he's cured of his leprosy. Now, we don't know much about Naaman's hockey ability. The Bible is silent about that. But I think we could guess that he was pretty good. So, yesterday at Hugh's funeral, Pastor Rachel talked about coaching. So, you know, this is like a weekend coaching meeting. When I think of the two of the greatest coaches, it's God and Bill Belichick, in that order. So I'm sure that God was inside that servant, and maybe God sent that servant to Naaman to try to talk him out of storming off in a rage and getting him to instead bathe in the River Jordan and be cured. And now I think about life here at Aldersgate, and when I look out to all of you guys, you're a pretty coachable group, right? And that's really great, right? I mean, when you think about all the things that this church accomplishes, it's because we're all willing to step up and do something to help. And maybe we don't agree with it. I'm sure we don't agree with every decision that somebody, you know, trustees or ad board or finance makes, or something that Pastor Rachel does. I mean, we almost never agree with stuff that Pastor Rachel does. But as part of the greater good, we still do it. And think about what we've seen over the last couple of years, even just over the last couple of weeks, right? People come up and they join the church, and what do they talk about? They talk about the way they're greeted warmly at the door. They talk about not being treated the same way when they were Catholic or something like that, or at a different church. They talk about feeling welcome and included here. And they talk about all the work that the church does. And in a way, kind of, your life at Aldersgate mirrors kind of the life of a coach, in a sense that, like, there's a desperate call for somebody to come out and volunteer, and you find yourself greeting, you find yourself working a breakfast, you find yourself on a roof in Maine trying to repair a leaky roof. And it's a good thing, and it feels good, and you're enriched by that. And I think over the last 6 or 7 months, that third Sunday is all about people's testimonies. And to kind of go along with the sermon, those are moments when people are coachable, right? They feel God's presence in their lives, and they decide to, they have two choices, and they make the one that God is telling them to make. And it works out. The decision they make is the right one because God is on their shoulder saying, this is what you need to do. I have a lot of testimonies I could give, some are darker than others, so I'll give a light one right now. One day, Holly calls me or emails me and says, there's a bee's nest in our front bush, and my immediate reaction was, how is that my problem? I didn't actually say that, now it's out in the open. So she said, well, I'm allergic to bees and Lauren's allergic to bees, so you have to get rid of the bee's nest. I said, okay. So I went home and went outside and found the bee's nest, and it was good sized. But it didn't look like a bee's nest. It looked like something that's not a bee's nest. So went to the garage, got out the hornet wasp bee spray, went on the porch, shaking it up, and I'm not joking, I heard a voice in my head say, read the directions. And I never read the directions. And I was like, all right, I'll read the directions. So I read the directions and it said, you know, if trying to take down a hornet's nest, make sure you spray the spray into the hole, into the opening. And I said, okay, so I'm looking around, I don't see a hole. So I go back in the house and I Google, find a hole in the hornet's nest. And all these pictures come up of these hornet's nests that look exactly like the one in my bush. And all those pictures had a hole. So I go back outside and I'm looking at, but I don't see one. So I'm thinking it's on the opposite side. Still couldn't find it. So I went back in and I Googled, take down a hornet's nest without finding the hole in the hornet's nest. And really nothing came up. So, but what did come up was like a whole thing on the actual hornet's nest, right? These hornets are mean. So what I found out is that this wasn't just any regular hornet's nest. This was like a paper wasp nest or something. And the more I read about the, I think they're paper wasps, the more respect I had for them. I'm like, holy mackerel, they have it figured out. So they live to serve the queen, a lot like I do in my house. And they will die trying to protect the queen. And they have it all figured out, right? They have centuries. Imagine having a paper wasp figuring out the fact that, like, we can all be in the nest protecting the queen, but we need people outside of the nest to let us know when trouble's coming. And the hornet's nest was about the size of a football, and inside there could be as many as, like, 12,000 of these paper wasps. So I was like, okay. And then there was something I read that said, if you think you can outrun them, you'll be like stung like 6,000 times before you even take two steps. So I went back in the house and I said, well, I'm not getting involved in this. And the story's kind of funny, but kind of the thing is, like, if I never read those directions, because something in my head said, read the directions, and I swear it was God saying, read the directions or you're gonna get jacked up. I would never have done that. So, and I have other examples that I won't go into of how God has appeared in my life and saved me from peril, because there have been a few times where he has. If you think about what other people have talked about when they come up here and they give their testimonies, it's inspiring. And when I read through this a second, a third, a fifth time, because I did have a lot of trouble with this one, it occurred to me that I'm not coachable at all, like in a lot of areas of my life. So maybe if you get nothing out of this, maybe I get something out of it and I'll be more coachable. And yesterday when Pastor Rachel got up and spoke about you, and especially the two people who came up and delivered Hugh's eulogy, and hearing kind of the stories of old, you know, Hugh in his younger days versus Hugh in his older days, I can only surmise that that was a guy at one point in his life who was not coachable at all. And somewhere along the way, God spoke to him and he figured out that he needed to become coachable, and he ended up being a great coach and sponsor to a lot of people. And that's inspiring too. So I take inspiration from that. Hopefully you can take some inspiration from that. I'm toying with the idea of changing the ears. The JP will always be there. Those will always be my ears. But I wonder if maybe for some of us, we change the AH to after Hugh. Thank you.
A little bit. blocking changes happen, and then we'll pray for the offering. Let's pray. Thank you, God, for giving us a good word. Thank you for using our own life stories to teach us things. Thank you for giving Rob insight, seeing parallels into the Bible and his own story, and encouraging us to be coachable, that we can become your disciples better if we will listen to you and respond to what you ask us to do. God, please receive this offering we give you today for the ministries of this church. Bless it and multiply it to your service. We pray in Jesus' name. Give her a big hug. We've embarrassed you enough now, Susan, but we're just so glad that you're here. we have a 2-minute rule in worship, which is, after worship, please don't go talk to your best friend right away. You can talk to them anytime. Will you please talk to someone you don't know as well for those first 2 minutes? This is your permission to go ahead and ask their name if you don't remember it. Yes, Meryl?
I want to know what happened to the hornet's nest.
No, we had to pay somebody to take it down because I was just like, I was flat.
Okay. In case you didn't hear, the end of the hornet's nest story is that Rob, they paid for it professionally to be able to. Thank you for keeping us on task there, Meryl, and I hope that was very important. All right. Camille is getting fired up, has been fired up for the spaghetti extravaganza. We thank her so much. Camille, for your leadership for this event. It's coming up Saturday. It's a great opportunity to invite people to come here just to have a good time, to be in touch with Aldersgate community. Do you have any special announcements for us?
Well, I thank you all for signing up. As usual, this conversation is very welcoming and just responsive to. We do, however, need auction items. Those are items that, you know, clothes or hats or scarves or things that people can walk down the runway, so to speak, and have Bob, the privilege of Bob, be an auctioneer. So if you could donate items, that would be wonderful. Just kind of drop them off here before 4 on Saturday. That would be great.
Okay, so make sure to be in touch with Camille so she knows what's coming, knows what's planned for. There will be a separate church email this week just for that event, for the Spaghetti Western. I'll send it out tomorrow, so that's easily sent to your friends, forwarded to your friends, or put up on your Facebook or Twitter or whatever, so that you can invite people. Because we want it to be big, and the talent show is going to be great, and Eva's singing the Antsy Fancy Dance. So that's going to be worth the price of admission right there. Yeah. She's been excited for so long, a solo. Yeah. So that's this Saturday at 6 o'clock. Next Sunday is the final week of collections for the Venture Crew. Razors, shaving cream, and bar soap is what they're collecting. Bring it and put it on the table with the lilies, the mission table. Next week is the final week. We will be starting a common reading next week for 4 Sundays in a row, even though we have Mother's Day, even though we have Memorial Day. Anyone who's interested to join in a discussion of the 4 agreements, we'll be discussing 1 agreement each week after church. This is not out of the Christian tradition, but it is just so thoughtful and so interesting and has so many resonances with what we believe as well. I think it's going to be very fruitful. So this is what it looks like. You can get it however you get it. I got it on Amazon for $5 in 2 days. So you can do that pretty easily. If you want to join in any week, just drop in the next 4 Sundays to do the 4 agreements.
It's Tom Brady's favorite book,
that's right. I remember when I did research on it, yeah. So that's good advertising for that too. Final announcement, if any are interested this afternoon from 2 to 4 p.m., I will be over at Hugh's apartment. We're breaking up his household, and so the family's been through and taken items of meaning to them. Many of you have received things as you visited him over the last few weeks, but we need to clear that place out. So, for 2 reasons, for you to get a memento from him and also to help clear the place out, I stopped by this afternoon up at 279 Main Street to pick something up, and we will get it done as a team. All right. For celebration and thanks, there was nothing on the sheet. What does somebody want to celebrate or thank that a volunteer has done this week? Suzanne. Bobby, George, and Paul for putting the new lights up in the nursery. Let's give them a hand. Go take a look at that nursery. It changes all the time as Pam is getting that set up as a new classroom for her preschool. It really looks lovely. Wonderful progress. We're very blessed to have her. It will still be in use for us on Sunday mornings at the nursery. It's just also going to be a preschool classroom starting when she takes over that in June. If there's no other announcements, please stand for the benediction. May God, who gives us the Holy Spirit so that we might be coachable, and the Holy Spirit to be our coach, be with us until we meet again. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.